On this episode of EIC On The Move, we take a trip to Capri, Manhattan, and the Hamptons in the pages of Kevin Kwan's latest bestseller, Sex and Vanity. Kevin, of course, is the author of the spectacularly successful Crazy Rich Asians trilogy. And he's also no stranger to the Philippines, having been here twice to promote his books and get to know some crazy rich Filipinos. Today, together with another powerhouse, veteran broadcast journalist, the ageless Korina Sanchez, my friend and fellow fan, we are going to have a crazy fun time talking to the one and only Kevin Kwan.
Thank you, Raul. It's always lovely to be with you. It's 10 a.m. Manila time right now. I think 7 p.m. in L.A. where Kevin Kwan is. Welcome, Kevin Kwan, and thank you for transporting us all the way to L.A. right now and all the wonderful destinations in the book, if only for a few precious hours.
Welcome, Kevin, and congratulations on the release of your book.
Hello, hello.
The world has changed as we know it in the blink of an eye. How are you doing in this pandemic? How are you coping?
You know, I think like everyone else, I'm trying to cope, right? It's certainly a strange time. I was actually in isolation since last September writing this book. Okay. And, you know, when I write, I go into my writer's cave. I stop calling friends. I don't go out. I don't answer emails. Everyone sees this out of office that says, you won't see me till February, you know. And so I finally, you know, came out of my cave in February, turned in the book. I thought it was time to celebrate. It was time to start traveling again. And guess what happened? I couldn't leave the house, you know.
Yeah.
Within 2 weeks, I was back. So, I mean, I'm used to the isolation, but it's still, it's a very, very weird time. And of course, you know, I'm very concerned about people around the world, concerned about friends and family, like everyone else, you know, one day at a time, as they say.
Kevin, we are so thrilled. Of course, Filipinos, we're very thrilled you've included two Filipino characters, actually, in your book. And we're wondering, could you give us an exclusive and tell us who the sisters are? The sisters will be included in the movie version, I suppose. And the next question would be, does that mean two very lucky Filipino actors will be playing the part?
Well, you know, I'm always so inspired when I visit the Philippines because I meet, to me, the most glamorous women in Asia. So, you know, the Ortiz sisters really were influenced by two spectacularly glamorous sisters that I met the last time I was in Manila. You know, I shouldn't name any names for their privacy's sake, but yeah, you know, so definitely, you know, all my characters are influenced by real people. I have no imagination. I just observe people and I sort of change them a little bit for my purposes. And definitely, you know, I do this, so hopefully we can cast some amazing Filipino actors in the movie.
You heard it first here on EIC On The Move.
So you visited the Philippines twice before, Kevin. So is there going to be a third time? Because rumor has it you have friends in Negros. Is that your favorite happy place when you're in the Philippines that you intend to again visit?
Well, actually, I've been to the Philippines more than twice. I've made some private visits as well, you know, that weren't book tour related. And the first time I went was back in the early 90s. So, you know, it's a country and a place that I love. And, you know, Negros is beautiful. But, you know, there's so many happy places in the Philippines for me, you know.
The family of my husband, they're all chefs. And one of them has been hailed as one of the best in Asia, Margarita Flores. So we're very Ilonggo. They're from Bacolod. They're from Negros. And we would be glad to host. And, you know, have you taste everything that's good that's from that part of the country. So
well,
after
I've been fortunate enough. I've been very lucky enough to have Margarita's food. So I know exactly what you're talking about.
And, so you know that. Yes.
Absolutely.
You know that.
For Capri, the island that feeds my soul, and for New York, the city that took me in and nurtured me and changed me forever. That's how the book begins. So why did you choose Capri and Manhattan as the setting for your book?
Well, Sex and Vanity is the first book in a new trilogy, And I call it my cities trilogy because it's really inspired by different cities that, you know, I truly, truly love. So each book will feature a major city and a minor city. So in this case, Capri is the minor city and New York is the major city. The next book in the trilogy will feature London and another city that I'll keep mysterious for now. And the final book in the trilogy will be set in Paris.
Right.
Exactly. But yeah, you know, both of, you know, Capri and New York are both such amazing, you know, sort of places that have affected me and inspired me so much. And that's why I wanted to just, you know, have the excuse of writing a book set in those places.
Yeah, you know, I read a book, I read another book, and the author said that Capri, he thinks, and he's traveled worldwide, he thinks that Capri is the most beautiful place in the world, and that's for him. So, Raul and I have never been there. It's in our bucket list. And yes, after yes, reading definitely. Your book, yeah, that's going to be one of our first destinations when we can already travel, Raul.
Yeah, after the pandemic.
After the pandemic. But you and I have been in Manhattan. And we were talking about it a while ago, Manhattan for you is education, right?
Yeah. I used to go to school in the West Coast, and I would always go take my holidays in Manhattan during my break. So Manhattan was like a playground for me during my holidays. And you, Korina, what was Manhattan to you?
Well, Manhattan is really my love story. That's where my husband and I got it going. I don't know what I'm not sure how you want to interpret that, but they have an apartment there. So yeah, it's like our second home in the world, New York. But for Kevin, I'm wondering, is that really the biggest part of your life? And so what is Manhattan for you?
I mean, moving to Manhattan changed my life, really. I went there for college. I was 21 years old and went there to do my second degree. And it was really, truly the first place I felt at home after leaving Singapore at age 11. You know, I spent 10 years in Texas. But I, as much as I appreciated Texas, I never felt like I truly fit in. You know, I always say it took me 10 years to make 6 friends in Texas. And then I moved to New York. And within 2 weeks, I had 30 new friends, all of whom are still great friends today. So, you know, the city really took me in and welcomed me, and I was inspired. I went to school there. I was lucky enough to go to Parsons School of Design and go to art school and then work for some amazing people. And I spent 22 years of my life there. And it's still, to me, it's still home. You know, even though I've been in LA now for the last couple of years, I still, you know, most of my friends are still back in New York. Most of my clothes are still back in New York.
So you maintain a home there, right?
I do. Yes.
Right. Yeah. Well, I have at least 30 cab driver friends. Every time I ride a cab, they become my friends. I don't know why. I love chatting with the cab drivers. Okay. So Kevin, Sex and Vanity, it seems to pay an homage to E.M. Forrester's A Room with a View. I mean, you even use the same names like Lucy, Charlotte, George. Although it begins with a room exchange, you take it much further than that. Is that by design, and why? Why A Room with a View, and why those characters' names?
A Room with a View, the novel and the movie, were both sort of seminal works for me. You know, I was in my teens when I first read the novel, and it sort of blew my mind, you know, how, even though it was written in 1908, it was such a modern look and a modern take into the mind of a young girl. And of course, it's also introduced you to Italy, you know, and then seeing the movie, which I don't know if you've seen it anytime recently, it was made in 1985, but it still holds up. It still looks like it was made yesterday. It's so timeless. It's so beautiful. And the actors in it, you know, Helena Bonham Carter, Daniel Day-Lewis in his only comedic role ever, Judy Dench, Maggie Smith. It's such a perfect movie. And it truly made me fall in love and want to go to Italy. It's the movie that sort of made me sort of nag my parents for years and years until they finally agreed to do a family trip to Italy. And so we all went to Italy as a family. And that's when I discovered Capri for the first time in my life and fell in love with, yes, to me, it's, you know, one of the most beautiful islands in the world.
Wow, that's really great. So, Raul, I think you have a question about the two lead characters. Raul seems to be so fascinated with the characters in the book.
Yeah. Could you tell me more about Lucy Churchill and George Zhao? aside that from them being fabulously rich and outrageously good looking.
Yeah, well, you know, Lucy is interesting. You know, she was my reinvention of the original character, Lucy Honeychurch. And my Lucy is 19 years old when we first meet her, and she is biracial. Her mother is American-born Chinese, and her father is a New Yorker from a very old blue-blood New York family. You know, they call them WASPs, W-A-S-P, you know, White Anglo-Saxon Protestant. And it's a very specific clan of the elite of the elite East Coast. She's torn, you know, she's really pulled between two different races, two different classes, and two different men, you know, one of whom is George Zhao, who she meets at this fantastic wedding in Capri that she goes to. And George is a Hong Kong boy. You know, he's from Hong Kong, but he spent a lot of time in Australia. He's gone to boarding school there. He's become a surfer. So he's kind of like a surfer jock, but very smart. And as you said, yes, fantastically good looking. Because why not, right?
Yeah, why not? Yes.
Exactly, exactly. So Kevin, is it by design also that you choose Asians to be the lead characters of your books? Is it because there's a message, like an underlying message out there, like you want to introduce or reintroduce the Asians to the world I view in a different way? Like, are we going to be expecting books about an all-white cast or an African-American cast? Are you really dedicated to Asian stories in the West?
Well, first of all, you know, I write what I know. And so for the most part, I know how to write about Asian characters, you know, being one myself. But I am very much a champion for diversity, especially in the West, where I feel like it's so lacking. You know, any chance I get to really showcase amazing, attractive, smart, sexy Asians and put them on screen in TV, in films, in my books, that's what I'm going to do, because it's really, you really don't see that at all in most of the American media landscape. You know, I've been told by a lot of readers that Lucy is the first biracial heroine in a contemporary book in decades, which I find shocking. You know, I didn't write that purposely because of that, but it's so great to hear from all these biracial people in America who say, yes, thank you for writing about us. Thank you for showing that we have struggles too.
Biracials, I mean, they're the new... They're the new most beautiful people in the world right now. I think it's about time people embrace the reality of diversity. And I guess you already answered my next question, which is, why is Lucy so conflicted? Of course, you set her in the beautiful island of Capri, and yet you magnify her conflict. Is there something deeper than that? Is it something that you yourself have experienced, or is this conflict something you picked up from your lifetime, from your friends or family?
I think it's all of it. You know, I think for me growing up and becoming an immigrant in America, you know, I've certainly had my share of experiences and racism, but also it was fascinating to me to see how my biracial friends, they've all had such a different range of experiences, you know. There is no monolithic Eurasian or biracial experience. It really depends on where you come from, where you were born, where you're living, who your parents are, which cultures they emphasize, what they're proud of. So it's so different from person to person. And so I wanted to give life to that, you know, and I wanted to show that there are layers of complexity in the racism that exists in the world and especially in America. So what is it like for someone like Lucy, who comes from such privilege? You know, she's a girl that grew up on Park Avenue. She has a trust fund. She comes from such a, you know, privileged family. But at the same time, she is lost. She is completely lost. She's fighting against her Asian identity, her own appearance, because all around her, she gets conflicting messages from her society, from social media, you know, from her friends, from her own family. You know, her own cousin, who is a blonde and blue-eyed WASP, goes out of her way to constantly try to explain to people, oh, she's my cousin. You know, she looks Asian, but we're actually truly blood relatives. And, you know, she gets a lifetime of that. And you see how that adds up to become what she is. And that's why she makes all the very silly decisions she makes, you know, at the beginning of the book.
Well, I love Rosemary Zhao. I think she's my favorite, Kevin. She's loud, overbearing, and yet she's, you know, lovable and authentic. So again, is she a composite or is she someone real in your life?
Rosemary is a composite, I have to say. She's a combination of several people that I've met and known that I felt could make this really interesting, fun character.
Right.
And yeah,
right.
I love her too, because, you know, it's funny. There's so many different layers of colliding snobbery in the book. You know, there's still that interplay between old money and new money, Asian money and Western money, European money and American money, and levels of snobbery. And here comes Rosemary, who is like the Asian Elizabeth Taylor. You know, she is vulgar. She wears huge jewels. She's wearing turbans and gigantic hats. You know, she's fabulous. And she doesn't care what people think. And she speaks her mind, which is so rare in that world when everyone is so perfect and always trying to be so poised. So she's a breath of fresh air to me. And she's sort of like the voice of wisdom in the book.
Well, Kevin has a big, big fondness for grand, grand weddings. What is it about weddings in your books? They're a constant.
You know, my books are all about family, ultimately. And of course, the ultimate family occasion is either the wedding or the funeral, right? So, right, and I've done both grand funerals and both grand weddings in my books. You know, in this book in particular, I really wanted to, you know, show like a beautiful celebration. And yeah, you know, I love attending weddings, first of all, you know, and I've been to quite a few over-the-top weddings. And so for me, it's fun to see what happens. You know, you set the stage where a lot of drama can happen when you have all these people converging on one place, especially when it's a destination wedding, I think, because people can really, a lot of bad behavior comes out. And for me, that's fun to document in my books.
Now, about the wedding gown, the two Ortiz sisters called it, it resembled the potato sack. Was that pure snobbery on their part?
I think it's not even snobbery. It's they don't understand it. You know, I think they have a different style reference. They come from a world where, you know, they want to wear beautiful Valentino embroidered couture. And so when they see something that's so minimalist and modern and simple, they don't even, you know, they can't appreciate it, you know, just in the way that my mom can't appreciate my torn jeans, you know.
Hey, potato sacks were in vogue before, especially when Audrey Hepburn wore them.
Yes, that's true.
I mean, anything looks good on her, right? I mean,
exactly.
It was a fact before,
And the dress is inspired by a dress Audrey Hepburn wore. You know, it was a Givenchy couture dress from the 60s.
Exactly.
And it's just so pure and so simple, you know. But I think for the Ortiz sisters, they wanted a little more bling factor, you know.
Yes, right.
I see. So those Ortiz sisters, did you base it on actual people you met while visiting Manila? Anyone we know, Kevin?
I did. Maybe someone you know.
He's not saying.
I'll never tell.
He's not saying. Oh, no.
We have to take it out from him, Korina. You have to convince him.
I know, but we have our headlines already, Raul. We can't push our luck too much.
Okay. Kevin, when you introduce characters in your book, there's always the college or school provenance beside their name. Is that enough to judge a person's social standing?
I think for a lot of people it is. You know, I mean, for me, I wanted to poke fun at that. I wanted to poke fun at education snobs, you know, because I went to public high school. I went to a public university, thought I had a great education. And then I moved to New York. And in my early 20s, you know, I was going to parties and I was meeting all these young East Coast elite types. You know, every time you would meet them, within 3 minutes of shaking their hand, they would tell you, I went to Harvard, I went to Princeton, I went to Stanford. Where did you go? You know, everyone's always announcing their entire educational resume. So I thought, you know, I'm just going to put it all out there in this book so you can see and judge them immediately. So it became a funny joke to do. But I really took time to really craft it for each character, to really imagine, you know, where they would have gone to school.
Lucy Tang is both Asian and WASP. So what differentiates between Western high society and Asian high society?
I think more and more the lines are blurring because it's now become an international group of 1%, right? They all know each other. The 1% of Manila knows the 1% of Hong Kong. and they know the 1% of, you know, the Parisians, and they know the New Yorkers. So it's become a global elite that's becoming very similar. They eat at the same restaurants. They travel to the same places and stay at the same hotels. They wear the same designers. So it's, to me, there's less differentiation these days. But I think on the whole, in Asia, there's a different emphasis, I think. You know, here, the wealth in Asia, I think they're still, they're living lives that have more ostentation, at least, you know, from what I can see, you know. Whereas in the West, it's more about personal luxuries. It's about, you know, what you can do to improve your very, very private life.
Kevin, is there an editorial somewhere there? Is it something? Is it an advocacy for you, or are you just stating it as a fact that, for example, many of your descriptions of ostentatious jewelry, fashion, you know, a New York townhouse with a gondola inside it, and yet racism seems to be there, though subtly, but still present. Is it something you think that is evolving? Is it something you wish wasn't there? Is it inherent insecurity of the Asians amongst the Caucasians?
Well, you know, I think all my books, they're satirical, they're satire. And I try to use satire to really sort of enlighten people on different facets of society. And one of them, to me, is wealth inequality, you know? I think that's a part that's a theme that's always present in all my books. And so I really poke fun at it. I poke fun at the ridiculousness of someone that would have a gondola and a canal in the middle of his living room, for example. And you think that's far-fetched, but it's not. There are far worse and more obscene things I've seen in New York houses, you know, than a gondola and a canal. it's my way at really jabbing at what I think are crazy things that really shouldn't exist in this world sometimes. And I do want to examine racism. I do want to examine all these issues that I think are part of our world. But I try to tell it in a joke rather than, you know, in a curse. I try to like enlighten with humor. That's my style.
Right. So Kevin, did you have your own experiences of like going into a restaurant, a Mario Batali restaurant or a 5-star restaurant and being seated at the back? I mean, I've been through that.
Yeah.
Does it still happen? Did it happen to you?
The New York restaurant seating game is a whole world unto itself. And I think a lot of times it has very little to do with the color of your skin and more about, you know, how VIP are you? You know, how well do you know the chef? How long have you been eating at the restaurant? So there's a very complicated calculus that I can't even get into. But yeah, I think there's just levels of exclusivity and snobbery everywhere, you know, and you see it in high relief in New York. I personally, you know, I think I've been luckier than most, but it's interesting. You know, I've had experiences where I go to these ultra exclusive establishment places, like the private clubs, you know, like the private dining clubs and things like that, where you really do see that they have these different rules. You know, there's a chapter in my book where Cecil can't go into a private club because he's not wearing a collared shirt.
Yes.
And that actually happened to me. You know, I was invited to one of the most exclusive private clubs, you know, on the East Coast. And so, you know, I got dressed up. I thought I was dressed very respectably. I thought I was actually dressed quite formally, you know, for a daytime event. And I wore a very, very nice sweater, but it didn't have a collar. And they didn't care. They're like, oh, no collar, you can't come in. So they created this really strange rule. When I'm actually very dressed up compared to most of the other guests, there were children running around in shorts and flip-flops and dirty collared shirts. You know what I mean? Yeah. But just having that, you know, they belonged. They were members of the club. And so I think a lot of these establishments, they create these strange rules to keep the riffraff out, you know, because only the members would know what the rules are. You know, there's a club in New York where the men all go to the swimming pool and they swim naked, believe it or not. And you wouldn't know it if you weren't a member, if you weren't indoctrinated into this world, you know, that this is the custom, you know, since 1900, the gentlemen of these of this fine establishment have been, you know, you strip before you get into the pool.
Wow, so, I want to see that. I want to do a story on that, Raul. Okay. I'm going to beat you to it.
So, Kevin, in this latest book of yours, there's a lot more sex and heat than the previous three books. Why is this so?
Well, I mean, the title is called Sex and Vanity, you know, but yes. It is a romance. It's a fun summer romp. It's meant to be sexy. I still think it's quite PG, you know, but yeah, I it was my new, you know, I'm always trying to do something different, right? And so I needed to spread my wings and really try new territories and find new styles of writing. And hopefully readers will come along for the ride. But, you know, I think there's a lot more vanity than there is sex.
Sex.
In fact, if anything, I heard some complaints that there wasn't enough sex in the book.
Sex,
but you know, but sex scenes are the hardest things to write. They're terrible to write. To make it fun and interesting and not make it cringeworthy is really, you know, it's a tall order.
Let's talk more about vanity. Vanity in small doses is, I think, fine. It can be destructive and distracting. But I think one good thing about being Asian is that we can take the sun quite well, right? Raul has a perennial tan. But I really laughed at the way Charlotte said that her 42-year-old skin tanned looked like an alligator Birkin. So is this, what is your limitation to vanity, Kevin? What do you think is acceptable and what is laughable?
You know, I think it really depends on each individual, right? You know, it's for me, ultimately, it's are you doing it to please other people or are you doing it to please yourself? You know, if you're dressing for yourself, if you want to look young, if you want to have cosmetic surgery to make yourself feel better, that's one thing. But when you're trying to change yourself and torture yourself just to fit into society or just to get the approval of other people, that's where I think it gets a bit sad, right? So, but for me, vanity in this book is more than just the surface level. It's more than skin deep. It's, we're looking at a world, you know, that Lucy's part of where people are so obsessed with social media, you know, where it's all about the selfie. It's all about how you present yourself on Instagram. It's the public image that's more important than what happens internally in your life. And I think that is what she's sort of having to struggle against, to see how much she wants to participate in that world or not.
Okay, let's talk about Asian representation. You know, the movie Crazy Rich Asians brought Asian actors and an Asian storyline to the forefront. Have you made any headway, Kevin?
I think things have changed tremendously in the last 3 years, you know, since Crazy Rich Asians. You've seen so many new movies, new TV series that really showcase diversity, not just from Southeast Asia, you know, from India, from around, you know, your things are getting much more international. And I think that's always a good thing. I think things are really changing for the better. It's exciting. It's a very exciting time to be part of all this and to see what I hope is meaningful change in Hollywood. Because they're finally taking notice that people want this. You know, people in America, people around the world, they want to see new faces. They want to see diverse faces. They want to see stories that they've never heard before from around the world. Mm-hmm. And so let's give that to them.
Okay. Right. So with China Rich Girlfriend and Rich People Problems come to the screen also, are you already filming it?
We are not filming it. We were supposed to film it this year. We were going to, you know, the plan was to start filming this fall. But of course, with the pandemic, it's really, you know, it's kind of changed all the schedules. And so it's still in development. And we're very hopeful that we can hopefully start filming next year.
So I guess we have to, wait even longer for Sex and Vanity. If China Rich Girlfriend and Rich People Problems get filmed before this latest book of yours?
I mean, not necessarily, because they're, you know, they're being done by different studios. So the Crazy Rich Asians movies are being done by Warner Brothers, you know, who did such an amazing job with the first movie. And Sex and Vanity was optioned by Sony Pictures, So it's a different studio. It's a different team. So, you know, they might have a different schedule. I mean, it's still very early days because we just finalized the deal. But they're so excited about this book. So you never know. It you know, could possibly come out at the same time or before. Who knows, you know?
Well, I'm excited. I'm excited about the vaccine so that I can get excited about your movies.
So am I. Start filming. So am I. A vaccine or a really good treatment. You know,
exactly.
So we don't have to be afraid of getting on planes, you know, so I can take that jet and come to the Philippines safely without worrying.
Yeah, exactly. Kevin, you like putting up, making characters make cameo roles in each other's books. Like, I think in this book, you had Astrid and Madame Shang Sui come into the picture. You like doing those things.
He calls
I like
them
putting
Easter eggs,
little Easter eggs in the books for the fans. And there's quite a few of them. You have to look at them. They're buried. Some are buried more deeply than others. So hopefully it's a fun treat for my readers of the trilogy.
Yes.
To sort of find things in the new book.
Yeah. Define luxury now in the midst of this pandemic. What is luxury in the new normal?
I think for each person it's very different, but I think I'm seeing in America at least, you know, people want to feel safe and people are really kind of nesting. And it's all about being able to sort of be someplace safe with your friend pod and have exclusive experiences, you know, your private yoga instructor, for example.
Right.
That is COVID free. you know, I see a lot of people have escaped to their country houses. Just the luxury of having a second home that's not in the city. That's kind of the big bragging rights now, you know. I heard about a woman that had an entire surgery, a whole operating theater and a life support system installed in her home so that she doesn't have to leave if she gets COVID. She can have her own ventilator or this and that. You know, I mean, that's the height of just, you know, luxury, but come on, you know, I mean, we're desperate for good healthcare and you know, there's such a shortage of ventilators that it's, you know, it is what it is.
Korina, what's luxury to you now?
Well, to me, luxury is having a haircut. Well, I've been cutting the hair of everyone in the house and they all have this COVID-19 look. It's all jagged. Reassure that it will grow back. So, well, luxury to me is just having my nails done by someone who swabbed, and swabbing, it costs a lot in this country. Yeah. So it's not very often that you can have enough to get everybody swabbed for your glam team. But it's not about just being glamorous. I think it's just really basic things that you need for yourself that we used to take for granted. But today, just going from point A to point B is a luxury.
Yes, true.
So I think it's a great time to reflect on what really matters and what we should be appreciating more of during normal times.
Yeah, I really try to think about gratitude, you know, every single day and just sort of being in the present. And every day I wake up and even if I don't want to get out of bed, I think I'm lucky to be healthy yet another day. You know, I'm lucky to be in a place where, you know, I feel safe. And that to me is so important. Yeah. And it really has really kind of changed a lot of my priorities that I think will continue even after the pandemic. There's so much, you know, we've all taken for granted that I think that's going to change. And I wish you could cut my hair because my hair is just, it's a rat's nest.
It's way
too long. Every time I see my mother on Zoom, she's complaining about my hair. And I was like, well, what do you want me to do? Do you want me to like go out there and get sick just getting a haircut? You know?
Like I cut the furs of all my dogs. So
I
practiced with the pets first and then came my children, then my husband. Yeah. I get better all the time with each time.
I know you've been asked several times whom you would cast for the movie version of Sex and Vanities. And because this is Manila, Korina and I have our picks among our Filipino actors. For Lucy, I would suggest Kelsey Merritt. And for George, I would suggest Sian Lim.
Wow. Yeah, you know, CN kind of looks like Henry Golding.
Okay, yeah.
Yes, that's him.
Exactly. Yeah.
He talks very well. And then Liza Soberano is a beautiful combination of Asian and, well, some other race. I'm not sure if she's American or Canadian or European, but she's a beautiful girl. She speaks English very well.
Yes.
Gorgeous, yeah.
Yeah, and for the guy, maybe Daniel Masunaga comes to mind because he's a beautiful Japanese-Brazilian tall person. Can also speak English very well. So there are a lot to choose from, actually, from the roster of entertainers here in the Philippines. But those two really stand out for me.
There's such a wealth of talent, you know, in the Philippines that it would be so fun to cast them in projects.
Right.
So I'm really fighting to create more shows, more films, more TVs that can really show off the talent of your country.
Before we let you go, Kevin, we'll play a short game. It's called Spitfire. Please answer whatever comes out, first thing that comes out in your mind.
Okay. Should I be afraid?
No time to think.
No time. Yeah. Just whatever comes into mind. So, Korina, why don't you start?
Okay. So, what do you wear going to sleep, Kevin?
Shorts and t-shirt.
Okay. First person you would hug after the pandemic?
Oh, my mom.
Oh, you haven't seen her for a while?
I have not seen her since December.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. When was the last time you cried?
I actually can't remember. I was such a crybaby as a kid. I think I did all my crying then, because even starting as a teenager, like I don't cry anymore. It's very, sometimes I want to cry, but I can't cry.
And because you're a New Yorker, that's why.
Maybe, yeah, I'm hardened. My blood has turned to steel and concrete, maybe. I even look for movies that will make me cry, and I can't ever find any. So, yeah. Sorry, can't remember the
onions,
last time.
Onions would do it. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Rachel Chu or Lucy Churchill?
Ooh. Well, Lucy, for now, just because she's on my mind, and I just wrote a book about her. Yeah. But I love Rachel.
Okay. The number of bottles of wine that you've consumed since the lockdown?
Oh, that's very easy. Not even more than one, actually. I really don't drink that much because I have to be very healthy with my liver.
Oh, you know. Okay.
Doctor's orders.
Yeah. Which is more than I can say for both Raul and myself. So let's sip that.
Yeah, you're very lucky.
Okay. First place you would fly after the pandemic or post-pandemic?
Oh, wow. I'd love to come to Palawan. Lie on the beach and have someone bring me food because I'm so sick of cooking. I can't even tell you how sick of cooking I am.
Okay. What do you think is the best thing about the lockdown?
You know, I've really reconnected with so many friends and family that I haven't had time to talk to in ages and ages. So that's been really, really wonderful. High school friends, you know, cousins from overseas. It's been really nice to reconnect with a lot of people.
Okay.
Worst thing about the lockdown?
Every single day. I mean, what can you say? Just not, you know, I was such a restaurant person and I have not eaten in a restaurant since March the 11th, I think.
Wow.
So just for someone that just is, you know, is social, that goes out just to be at home. And yeah, it's been terrible.
I know. I agree. Yeah. I agree. So now the last question is, who do you consider crazy rich Asians in the Philippines?
I think there are a lot more smart rich Asians in the Philippines than crazy rich Asians. How's that for an answer?
Well, Raul and I are crazy and Asian, but not rich.
Yeah, not rich.
Fantastic.
Okay, so Raul, I think, we've run out of time and questions.
Yes. So
thank you for having me, Raul.
Thank you so much for being my guest host. Kevin Kwan, thank you very much. It was a privilege to have spent an hour with you today.
It's been so fun. Thank you so much for taking the time. And it's an honor to be having this time with you too. And I hope you will all be safe and we can all meet in person very soon.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Thank you, Korina. Capri awaits. We're ready to go, okay?
I know. We have to both be there with our bottle of wine.
Yes, exactly. This is Raul Manzano, and this has been EIC On The Move. Shop safely and conveniently for homeschooling and distance learning supplies from National Bookstore. Visit the homeschooling section at nationalbookstore.com or from their official stores in Shopee and Lazada for activity books, paper supplies, art materials, home classroom needs, and more, and have them delivered straight to your doorstep.